I'm going to call on Matt because he has a very special introduction to make this morning.
Good morning. Would you please welcome my wife, Christina, and the newest member of our family, Elizabeth Shea Scott. On behalf of Tina and I, I'd like to thank you all for your prayers, for your kind words, your notes, and your gifts. It means a great deal in this time, and we are excited to share Elizabeth with y'all. I know a lot of y'all have been demanding pictures, but I thought this would be better. Elizabeth had her shots this week, and so Dr. Fish cleared us to come and share her with you. You can watch, but you can't touch. And what's the other rule, Dr. Fish? If you have coughs, then stay. He said, don't breathe. But thank you all for your encouragement and support of us all. We wanted to share.
We look forward to our time together as we move into this new year and as we worship here together this day. Be aware that God has come here before us, and let us welcome our Lord, our God, our Christ, our Holy Spirit, that we may be enthused with worship this day for our glorious God.
Oh,
Thank you, Michelle, for that lovely song. Would you all please stand and join in praying our opening prayer? Let us pray. Loving Father, you have called us to go and serve others, but for this hour, you have called us here to remember who you are. Your glory is above the heavens. You have set the moon and stars in place. You have made us a little lower than angels and crowned us with glory and honor. You have blessed us with life, breath, and beauty. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we come to open our hearts to your abundant life. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Amen. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, number 64, Holy, 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 Lord God.
Thank you.
How good it is to be together as this family of faith, and in these moments we have an opportunity to show Christ's love to one another. As we come to greet one another with signs of God's peace, let us remember, God makes peace within us. Let us claim it. God makes peace within us. Let us share it. Thanks be to God. Let us share it. These things we ask in the name of Jesus the Christ, our beautiful Savior, our precious Lord. Amen. We're glad that each and every one of you are here. We do want to know of your presence, so as our ushers are coming forward, we invite those of you here to locate the book of registration. You'll find it in a pew right in front of you. Take a few moments to fill it out, share it with others, and then to greet one another following the service. As our ushers now come forward for our morning offering, we prepare to give of our gifts to the Lord. And for those of you who are watching live stream, if you too desire to give, you can do so by going to our website. And now, let us join in prayer together. Thank you, God, for showing us a better way to live than we are able to devise for ourselves. Thank you for inviting us into rest and blessing. We know there are many who are unable to rest. May these gifts be used to bring your great love and care to those who are weary and homeless. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Shema Israel.
Shema Israel.
Adonai Eloheinu.
Adonai
Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. For Labor Day this morning, we find ourselves at the beginning of Scripture in Genesis 1. Hear now the word of the Lord. And God said, let us make mankind in our own image, in our likeness. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And God saw that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. And by the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating all that he had done. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. I thought it relevant, given that my wife and I are new parents and don't get much rest, that I would preach to you all about the importance of rest, as we are finding in our home how much we miss it. I also thought it fitting, given this being a Labor Day weekend before the rush of the fall gets going full speed, that we review this important call from the beginning of all creation for all of us to slow down and rest. Many of you have been in this situation my wife and I are in. This is the first grandbaby on both sides, so we didn't have the benefit of watching a sibling go through this, so we were surprised to find out that the baby needs to eat about every 1.5 or 2 hours, which means we have to be awake to feed the child, which means we essentially do not sleep in the beginning. When we went to see our pediatrician, he reminded us that a sleep cycle for a young child is about 2 hours, and for an adult it's 3 to 4 or even more, and so as they're continuing to wake up, and we are as well, we don't get sleep and we slowly start to deteriorate. I had heard about sleep deprivation, but never experienced it at this extent for this length of time. And I found myself in the first few weeks starting to lose my functions and abilities. My wife pointed out that I was starting to transpose words, leave things out of sentences, and just generally not make any sense, or at least more than usual. We returned to the hospital to meet with a lactation consultant, who asked me to add 3 single-digit numbers, which I couldn't, and I ended up converting ounces to milliliters, and she looked at me like I was crazy, to which my wife patted me gently and said, he doesn't get much sleep. What we have discovered in our house in the last 2 weeks is that sleep deprivation is real, and without rest, the body essentially shuts down and does not work. One of the things I came across in preparation for this morning was that sleep deprivation is akin to very low functioning. So they use the example of driving a car. If you're sleep deprived enough, driving a car is akin to driving under the influence. You can't really function without rest. In fact, the body is made up to have natural rhythms of rest that without which we essentially start to go crazy. I won't address how that's been in my house, but fortunately, our child starts to sleep more and more, and we're recovering well. But one thing I did realize the other day, and I apologize to Holly, our new senior pastor, I said, Holly, I realize you've never seen me fully functioning. I said, I promise my brain is going to start working better and better. But rest is a part of what we are called to. It is a necessity, if you will. And I will go even further this morning as to say it's part of our identity. Part of what God is reminding us of in this creation narrative this morning is that rest is part of the fabric of not only who we are, but the overall world in which we live. There is a rhythm to the passage this morning where each day God creates, and at the end of the day it says, there is the evening, there is the morning, the first day. There is the evening, the morning. And then it culminates with this creation of male and female on the sixth day, and as he's recognized everything each day has been good, the works of his hands, now he stops after the sixth day and says it is very good. Whereas you remember when in the other creation narrative in Genesis 2, when he said it's not good for man to be alone, and then he creates Eve, which he realizes or recognizes is very good. And then after we have this recognition in Genesis 2, we have this special seventh day that God has created and set apart. This rest is part of our identity. It's part of who God creates us and calls us to be from the very first day of all creation. One of the writers that I read this week pointed out that man and woman are created just in time to take a nap. There is creation and then there is the evening. The reality of this rhythm of we are given this gift of rest. When we come onto the scene of creation, we have done nothing to earn or deserve this rest. It is a grace or a gift given from God, and God gives it freely. This rest is part of our identity of what God calls us to. And as theologians point out, the invitation of rest requires a few things from us. It requires us to step out and trust, to trust that God is who God says he is, and that we are who God says God is. We talk here extensively about God as our loving Father and us as his beloved children. And we see this reality in this narrative here where God begins with creation and giving us this gift of this first day of rest. Theologian Ellen Davis writes that Sabbath is not just a day. It's a whole set of practices. It is a principle of human existence that you have to stop everything and regularly recognize that God is the creator of heaven and earth. And I would add on that we are not. This invitation to rest recognizes that God has done his work of creation and invites us to join him in that rest. And Dr. Davis points out that the first thing we have to do to enter into this rest is one of the most difficult things in my opinion. It is to stop. It is to cease. It is to slow down and to let go. Trusting that there is an abundance that comes to me as gift, and that there is sufficiency in this gift, that it takes courage and also community, Dr. Davis writes. These habits come from our community, and I would offer, friends, our community of faith. Dr. Davis goes on, if our religious communities are healthy, they are teaching us how to live in trust. They are teaching us that it is safe to stop, that you don't have to work all the time, that work and rest and work and Sabbath are a rhythm in the Bible that we are all invited to. She goes on to be as bold as to say, if our work is to be eligible for a blessing, it has to be part of this rhythm that entails stopping and acknowledging that God is God. And as I said before, that we are not. Sabbath is an act of trust in God that he is who he says he is, that we are who he says we are, and to put our very lives into that trust. Rest is also a shift in focus in our lives, a shift from creating and building and acquiring things to a shift of a focus on time and space, of letting go, of slowing down. Abraham Heschel writes about Sabbath, pointing out and highlighting the reality that Sabbath is not about rest to make us more efficient. You've heard this line before, we need to take the weekend off so we'll be fresh Monday and hit the ground running. of the creation narrative is that God is saying, I am taking the rest and you are called to join me. Not from the work you have done, but from the work that I have done. Heschel goes further to explain this rest as a taste of the eternal, a touch of the divine. We are taking the day off on Sabbath to practice eternity, he says. Think with me of John when he talks about knowing God in chapter 17 as eternal life. This is this knowing. This is that abiding. This is abide in the vine. This is the foretaste of where we are headed. Sabbath also recognizes that enough is enough. It puts boundaries on our work and our lives, and the focus as well. Sabbath is a healthy boundary where the rush of production is stopped and we enter into a different reality. We begin to discover a deeper sense of what God has created us for, this deep sense of belonging and abiding, this connection. As we make space in our lives to slow down and to let go, we realize these truths. Author Walter Brueggemann writes on the Sabbath as a resistance, and he highlights three realities we learn in this creation narrative about the gift of rest. He said that divine rest on the seventh day of creation has made three things clear. First, that God is not a workaholic. Second, that God is not anxious about the full functioning of creation. There are more important things to God than just our productivity. And third, that the well-being of creation does not depend on endless work. Friends, how busy are our lives? How much do we identify with the treadmill of productivity? Recently, Holly shared with us the feedback she got from young families in our community about the pressure we put on our kids to work so hard to get into good college, to work hard in college to get into a good grad school, to work hard in grad school to get a good job. At our good job, we have to work hard to get promoted. We get promoted and we have to earn enough to keep that role. The treadmill keeps going. It never stops. It's all driven toward that wonderful end of achievement and performance and acceptance and being enough. And the call to rest is a contrary narrative that says, from day one, you are worthy of a break. You are more than just productivity. You are more than just workers. And in fact, if we build the rest in before as a priority, we begin to recognize these things. We begin to see that the rhythms of life echo back to the eternal and remind us not just what we do, but who we are. As God invites us in John 15 to abide in him. As he talks about being the Prince of Peace, this idea of identity in wholeness and completeness, of rest in God. This is part of the design of our very fabric of our beings. Rest, in fact, begins our day. If you read in the early scriptures of Genesis, throughout the Old Testament, in the Jewish tradition, the day begins at sundown with rest. Rest begins all we do. The Sabbath begins our week. If you see it in nature, you see rest as part of the seasons. It weaves through all we do. If you listen to your beating heart, it's beat, rest, beat, rest, beat, rest. There is this rhythm of rest that is woven through all we do. Years ago, we went on a trip to Jerusalem and we were in the city for Sabbath, and we celebrated Shabbat in the Jewish quarter. And as we walked to dinner, we noticed what happens when an entire community slows down at the same time. And the only thing that people had to do was to go join with family and friends to celebrate in food at table and in worship. It's like if you go out to HEB on a holiday before 2 p.m., the streets are quiet and no one is out. Friends, what are the rhythms of rest in your lives? Where are the spaces that you create to slow down, to recognize that God is God and we are not, and to simply create that space? Scripture invites us to weekly worship together, to daily scripture study, to daily prayer, to slow down every evening, to sit at table with friends and family, to serve others, to peace and quiet, to all these kinds of things. I kept thinking about when we were kids, we were required to take a nap every day when we were homesick. What are the spaces you have created in your life from the hustle and bustle of daily life and striving and earning? Because friends, you know as well as I do, if we do not create those boundaries and hold tight to them, the busyness of our lives will take over. So what does this look like? How do we begin? Like the creation story, I think this begins with creating a little margin for rest. This holiday weekend is a wonderful time to start. Get up in the early hours of the morning before you start the busyness of the day and just sit and be. When was the last time you slowed down enough to hear the birds chirping outside or just the sound of your own breath? Many of the writers I read this week in preparation for this morning talked about what happens when we create that space in our lives. Our gaze is lifted from the daily distractions and duties we have, and we look above it all to the greater things of life. Many of them talked about looking to the stars, realizing the bigness of God in all creation, and realizing our smallness in it. That in that space that we create, something changes. We slow down, we let go, and we start to focus on something bigger than ourselves. And then inevitably, the still small voice of God enters, and we begin to encounter the divine. We begin to ask questions like, who am I and why am I here? We begin to have the space and the time to explore that. Friends, in this holiday season, I invite you not just practically to rest and cease from working and nap and sit on the couch, but I invite you to create space, to create time, to pray, to reflect on Scripture, to take a walk outside, to look at the stars. Be aware of God in your midst. Friends, it is there that we taste eternity and the touch of the divine. And friends, I encourage you to do this because without it, you will break down. And as you slow down, and as you create that space, invite the Lord in. Surprised at how you will encounter him in new and powerful ways. The gift of rest is there for you and for us all. I invite you this weekend to slow down and encounter him. Amen.
As we prepare to come to the Lord's table and feast together, I invite you to turn to page 12 in your hymnals, that together you may be in an attitude of prayer as we move through this time. Hear now this wonderful invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and who seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and with one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Thanks be to God. As we come now to the prayer of great thanksgiving, I invite you to continue in an attitude. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and good and a joyful thing always and everywhere
to give thanks to you, Father Almighty. And so with all your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. It is a sharing in the body of Christ. And when we partake of the cup, it is a sharing in the precious blood of Christ. I invite those who are assisting and serving this morning to come forward, and as they do, remind you that this is not a Methodist table, it is the Lord's table, and all are welcome here who love Him. And as we come, you will receive a piece of bread here at the altar rail, dip it into the cup, and receive the elements together. Following the receiving, we also experience a blessing of anointing with oil. And our anointers will be stationed on either side here. We come with joy, knowing that there are those in need, and so we also have an opportunity to leave an offering this morning on the rail. It goes to our United Methodist Holding Institute that is helping the migrants of the border. Let us come now with joy to feast. Christ invites us. Let us respond and rejoice with one another.
invitation to Christian discipleship this week comes from one of my favorite authors. Her name is Barbara Brown Taylor, and she offers this invitation. Once a week, quit being good for anything but your creatureliness and pleasure, the pleasure of no work and company and food. I invite you to try that out this holiday weekend. Now would you stand and join in singing our closing hymn, number 614, For the Bread Which You Have Broken.
Girls work out on